This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 135. So you want to put up a tower. Good luck with that. That may be a little bit long. Tell you what, I'm going to shorten it down to the WW8N tower case. And here's why. From QRZ.com, this story appeared a week or two ago. Let's see. Yeah, there we go. The WW8N tower case could set a precedent for all U.S. amateurs. What? Sounds pretty important. And we'll find out what that's all about in just a minute, but it's time for the commercial. Ham Radio Now is always brought to you by yourself through a contribution through Arvin back there. He's overseeing our financial situation. So stop by hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin's picture, whatever you think this program is worth to you. If you don't think it's worth anything, then just sit back and enjoy it and have a good time. So, the case is a ham in Ohio. His name is Gary, WW8N, and he has been trying since about 2005 to get a tower put up in his backyard. We all would like to be able to do something like that. This could have some serious repercussions. So here on my Skype line, I have not Gary, but a very famous ham radio attorney, Fred Hopengarten, K1VR. Fred, thanks for coming on Ham Radio Now.
My pleasure.
Why don't we start with the really big overview from about 1,000 feet or maybe 10,000 feet, and so people get an idea what it is we're going to be talking about, and then we will dig into some of the details of this case and probably a lot of stuff people would like to be able to hear about.
Sure. Gary Wadtke, WW8N, in Swanton, Ohio, which is in the Toledo area.
I tell you what, let me help you out with that. We got this Google map zooming in on Toledo. Swanton is a tiny little town west of the airport. I've been digging into this map. Okay, there's Swanton. It's a tiny town, right?
It's a small village, yes.
Okay, and way out there, in practically the suburbs of the village, is Gary's house. And the patio in the backyard, where he wants to put up the tower. And let me point out one other thing while we're here. Over here is a set of power lines. There's one big power line tower here. There's another one up there. And I believe that will figure prominently in the story at some point. So now we know. Maybe it will. Maybe. Okay.
Actually, if you were still back on the map, you'd see that there are trees to the rear of his lot and sort of a big open space across the street from his lot.
Okay. So it's not a wooded neighborhood. It's a slightly wooded neighborhood. There's
some foliage around. Backyards are wooded.
Okay.
So in 2009, basically, Gary went to the town and tried to apply for a building permit. And they said, no, you're going to need a variance. He wants to put up 60 feet of Rome 55G. On the order of half a year, I guess. The town turned down his application. And the reasons they turned down his application had to do with the fact that it didn't meet their reading of the ordinance governing towers. The only problem with that will come up later in the story, but he then proceeded to retain an attorney in Swanton. He's not experienced at hiring attorneys, and he just basically took on the first guy recommended to him.
I guess that's probably something that we all would do.
What I would recommend is that you try through your contacts, personal contacts, and any other professionals you know, like accountants or other lawyers, to get somebody who has knowledge of the general field in which your problem arises. For example, I know a lot about antenna law, but you really shouldn't ask me to get you a divorce. if I don't know if you're contemplating one. In any event,
I have to say immediately, no, Cindy, we're doing fine. I love you, honey.
Glad to hear it. He was turned down for his permit. Off they went to the Court of Common Pleas, which is the first level of court in the state of Ohio. And the judge, the process took 4 years. Neither party was really moving it along. And they don't have so-called rocket dockets or mandatory speedy trial kind of things in Ohio. So this one just sort of sat there while the parties were trying to figure out what was going on. Eventually, Gary called me and said, I asked if I would help out the local attorney. And shortly after I entered the case, we actually got a decision from the judge who ruled in Gary's favor. This was the first level of court in the Ohio system. And the way they do it there, you get a decision from the judge, and then before it can be appealed, there must be a final judgment which contains magic words, words special to Ohio, that allow it to be appealed. And when you come to that stage of the game, the lawyers submit a proposed final judgment ready for appeal.
So let me interrupt just briefly. Initially, this was a win. This was
the first round was a win.
Yeah. But
we haven't finished winning.
There was more to go, and it didn't surprise you.
The village submitted the first draft of a final judgment. They were the losers, but they submitted the draft, and it didn't please me.
But they did that so they could get their magic words in.
Well, everybody needs the magic words to get an appeal. Yeah. And in this case, they were the losers, so they wanted the magic words so they could start the appeal.
So they drafted it. Make sure it's
I didn't like that. I did not like that because after I entered the case, I took a very hard look at the ordinance, and I discovered that basically the town had been looking at the wrong part of the ordinance the whole time. They'd been dealing with the section of the zoning ordinance which dealt with commercial antennas, and amateur radio, by its very nature, is a non-commercial service. You find that right in the regulations, in the first section of the regulations. Yep. The judge took our draft, and now the town has appealed, and that's where we are.
Yeah. So the win. The first decision was last summer.
And that was a win for us, but not completely on the right grounds.
Yeah.
So and the second round win was an even stronger win.
Yeah, and then the appeal was filed in February, just last month.
Correct.
And that's why the story in QRZ, because that's why it came up when it did, because suddenly there's the appeal. But you were expecting the appeal.
All along.
So that was no problem. All right, let me bring some of this story home a little bit. That's Gary, and his mom on the right, and I'm assuming his wife on the left. So that was his 60th birthday. He is now 67, and having gone through all of this tower stuff, he probably looks a whole lot older than that now. Okay, so let's see a couple other things here. That's his house, and you can see the trees in the background. We looked at the overhead, so this is an idea of what things look like. There's the street that he lives on, looking down toward his house, and in the background you can see that tower for the power line.
Yes.
There's the backyard. Nothing has been installed yet as we look at this picture, but he's getting ready to put the tower in at the corner of that patio, and we're looking at the patio from the opposite direction, and there is the base of the tower starting to go in. So I'm not a tower building expert, and I think you probably are. This looks good. Is he doing it right?
This is beautiful work.
Okay. I'll have some questions about that in a minute. Poured the concrete, and it's setting, and it's just about done. And he started to build the tower. So it's partway up. I don't know what its status is right now, but as of that picture, it is about 30 feet. So he isn't waiting for all this to happen. He started to build the tower. Do you know if he's finished? Is it all the way up?
No. The parties have agreed that during the pendency of the litigation, it can go to 40 feet.
I read the original decision. This was from last summer. The village motion to dismiss.
No, it's his petition to ask the court for a decision in his favor.
Okay.
Should it not to be overruled.
All right. The next piece of language we haven't talked about yet, the general statute duly enacted by the legislature, and this is Ohio enacted a statute parallel to good old PRB1, something most of us are familiar with. And that is Ohio something 5502.031.
Yes.
The town thought,
revised statutes.
Okay. The town thought that should be ruled unconstitutional. That was part of their argument, right?
Yes.
They lost on that. Why did they think that would be unconstitutional? What's the deal in Ohio?
In Ohio, they have a very strong home rule statute, which says basically that the municipalities have a lot of power within their boundaries. And they're taking the position that this mini PRB1 statute interferes with and conflicts with the more powerful Ohio equivalent of PRB1. And they simply have chosen to ignore the fact that the Ohio PRB1 statute parallels the federal PRB1 statute. And they're not claiming that the Ohio Home Rule statute overrules the federal regulation. Because, of course, federal law is the supreme law of the land. But they haven't, they're paying no attention whatsoever to federal law, even though the judge did and ruled in our favor, among other reasons, on federal law grounds.
Okay, so this goes on to say that the plaintiff should be able to put up his tower as presented in his plans and specs as presented to the Planning Commission and the village council. So the judge basically said, yeah, he should be able to do it. But you knew the appeal was coming. He knew the appeal was coming. Everybody knew the appeal was coming. So there then the agreement to go to 40 feet and hold pending the outcome of the appeal. Have I got that right?
Yep.
Okay. All right. So now let's dig into some of the details.
Do you have the second decision, the one that's the appealable decision? Said all of the other things, plus it adopted something we threw in a little late in the process, but in time, pointing out that the maximum height of 40 feet applies only to commercial towers, and ham radio is not commercial. So they are saying that they have a 40-foot maximum height, and under the home rule statute, they're entitled to enforce it because the Ohio statute favoring amateur radio is unconstitutional. Their argument ignores the fact that the 40-foot height applies to commercial towers, not ham radio towers, and ignores the federal law as the supreme law of the land. So when they filed their appeal, what they did was, in Ohio you have to file something called a docketing statement, and the grounds for their appeal are listed. It says they're called the probable issues for review. And they list four issues. The scope of the village ordinance on towers and antennas, whether the Ohio revised statute that you've been speaking about, 5502.031, that regulates amateur radio service communications and structures is constitutional. And of course, we take the position that it is constitutional, and further that it's backed up by federal law. And then they argue that it does not take precedence over the home rule analysis. And finally, they argue that the administrative record, and I'm going to quote here, is devoid of documents, facts, or analysis. And that requires a remand, which is a little odd because there's a statement of facts that was submitted by both parties.
Yeah, what does that mean?
They're saying that even if they lose on the law, it has to go back to the village for further proceedings because there isn't enough on the record to make a decision. What they're saying is they really don't want the judge to just order the grant of the permit.
Is it a technicality, or is there something serious to it?
This business of remand is always a matter of controversy. In Telecommunications Act cases, basically the courts have gotten so tired of dilly-dallying by the municipalities that it is now routine for courts to order the grant of a permit as soon as possible without further proceedings.
I want to take a step back now and do something I should have done a little bit earlier in the program, and that is tell people why you're here. And part of that is this is your website, antennazoning.com. You had said that you're an expert in this, but you are seriously an expert in this. If you're not number one, you're up there in the top few.
Well, it's inappropriate for a lawyer to suggest that he can do any lawyering any better than other lawyers. But here's what I will say, which is entirely factual. I wrote the book on antenna zoning for the American Radio Relay League. And then I wrote the second edition of the book on antenna zoning for the radio amateur, which is now almost sold out as well. We've got 150 copies left. And I wrote for the Society of Broadcast Engineers, I wrote their book, Antenna Zoning Professional Edition, which covers broadcasters, cellular telephone, mobile telephone, things like that. So my elevator speech goes like this. If you want to put an antenna up high in the sky and the neighbors go berserk, call me.
I'm kind of thinking that if somebody wants to put up a tower, the first thing that they should do is buy your book. Well, and read it. The first thing before they do anything else.
It's a whole lot cheaper to buy and read the book than it is to hire me.
Well, but even if they need to end up hiring you, they'll probably have taken less dead ends and made fewer potentially fatal mistakes if they start there.
Absolutely. And the book has a CD on the back side of it. It's tucked in to the back cover with forms and letters and examples so that you can either learn from the mistakes of others or do it the way I tell you to do it.
Yep. I was at a radio club dinner last night with some folks from our local club. One of them is working on tower stuff here in the city of Raleigh, and he borrowed a copy of the book. His comment was, it's an expensive book, and it's $50 plus or minus. And I'm thinking, you're going to put up a tower, you're probably going to be spending $1,000 on the tower and another couple thousand on a good antenna on top, and feed line and tower and guy lines and grounding and everything else. A A $50 book is expensive?
I got to tell you, it's... If you want to call me on the phone, you know, you'll take what, 6 or 8 hours to read the book, and you'll get 15 minutes of my time on the phone. So the book is cheap.
Yeah. So people should start there. So you were saying that Gary didn't start there. He started looking for a local attorney. And I imagine that, I mean, in any case, a ham radio case or that divorce case, anybody's going to do pretty much that. They're just going to be hunting for a local reference, somebody that somebody says can do the job for them. How close did Gary get? I know you don't want to talk ill of the attorney that he got, but how close did he get in finding somebody who knew what needed to be done?
I want to tell you something nice about this attorney. Gary got him a copy of my first edition book, and the guy used the sample complaint as the form for filing. And as a result, he preserved all of the necessary issues. You got to give the guy credit.
So he got things off to a good start.
He did.
Did they go down any blind alleys, or did they make any mistakes that ended up being difficult to rectify later on?
Neither side read. They all sort of believed they knew what the definitions were. It's really important to read the definitions. So I'm going to read you the definition.
Okay.
Of a telecommunications tower in Swanton, Ohio. A structure designed and constructed to support one or more antennas used by commercial wireless telecommunications facilities and including all appurtenant devices attached to it. It can be freestanding or lattice or monopole. And nobody looked at the fact that it's, by definition, an ordinance aimed at commercial towers.
Did they have anything aimed at hams?
Nope.
So does that leave hams in the clear or in some ambiguous limbo?
Here's the way the law sets it up. If there's no ordinance controlling the height of amateur radio antennas, then amateur radio antennas, speaking generally, are controlled by the maximum height ordinance in the municipality. Normally, that's 2 stories or 35 feet. An ordinance which has a firm, fixed, and maximum height of 35 feet is an illegal ordinance because it fails to meet the requirements of both the Ohio and anywhere it occurs in the United States, the federal law.
PRB1
is codified. PRB1 was an FCC report and order. It has the power of law. But it was codified into a federal regulation, just like the FAA regulations, the IRS regulations. It's an FCC regulation, 47 CFR 97.
Okay, so it's got some more serious numbers we're not going to remember.
You bet.
But we remember PRB1.
So PRB1 is all boiled down to one paragraph in the Federal Code of Federal Regulations. And basically, if you want to think about it this way, a firm, fixed, and maximum height is inherently incapable of being a reasonable accommodation because it's no accommodation at all.
I think I understand. But these things, they tend to become sort of tell it to the judge.
The city basically took the just say no position. They said, no, you can't have that. And if you don't like it, we have methods in the United States for dealing with it. You go to court.
Yeah. So
Gary did.
And a fair number of hams have done that. Probably not nearly as many as wish they could or had or will, but a fair number of hams have. And the results have not been uniformly positive for hams. I'm sure you have done all the research to, and you know where things stand, but some folks have won and some folks have lost, and they've lost permanently.
There have been basically two cases that turned out badly, and
really just two.
Unique. Other than that, most, if the hams handle it correctly, mostly they win.
Interesting. What are the reasonable things to expect to be able to do in various neighborhoods, or maybe not even neighborhoods, you know, different geographic situations? What are if someone were to come to you and say, I'm thinking about doing this and I haven't actually done anything yet, but here are the rules of my local area, and here's what I want to do. What would you counsel as the prudent directions to take and expectations to have about what you might actually be able to accomplish?
Okay, so the law is that the municipality must reasonably accommodate the radio amateur's communications, his desire for effective communications. The way to translate that is to begin with, what is it you need? Are we talking about VHF for emergency communications? I had a client in Albuquerque, New Mexico. One of his major desires was to be able to contact handheld walkie-talkies on 2 meters for people who are out on search and rescue, because he's heavily involved in the balloon flying of the Albuquerque area. And when the balloon goes down, they've got to go find that guy before something bad happens. So his need was enough height to cover an adequate amount of area on 2 meters. Other people have a need to talk to old friends, relatives, whatever, whether it's in Africa, Europe, Japan, Australia, wherever. They proceed in either VHF or HF cases to create a needs analysis. And we can do this using some standard software developed originally by the U.S. Navy, things like VOA CAP, and with the help of some software that's been written by N6BV while he was employed by the ARRL. In any event, you create the needs analysis. It shows that you need a certain height for the communications you desire. And under the FCC analysis, you're basically entitled to the height and dimensions necessary for the communications, for effective communications that the radio amateur desires.
So that's your definition of a reasonable accommodation.
Yes. Now, they can ask you to move it to the backyard. They might ask for something in the way of vegetative screening, but it can't be an impossible-to-meet requirement. For example, they can't ask you to completely hide your 120-foot tower.
Right.
Because you can't go by 120-foot trees. So there's some room for negotiation, and basically there's a requirement that the municipality has to negotiate with a radio amateur and seek to reasonably accommodate his need for the effective communications he desires.
Do you find most municipalities do that in good faith, or does it start as a fight most of the time?
You know, surgeons only see cases that need surgery.
I see the problem here.
I only see the cases where there's a fight. It's either brewing or has already erupted.
Well, I mean, don't people just at Hamfest and everything tell you their war stories? And I guess maybe if it's a war story, there was a war.
Well said.
somebody out there has a story of how it worked really well. Call Fred and tell him it went beautifully from start to finish, especially because you bought his book and went through that to begin with. And
it led you all the right directions.
Okay, so that does happen.
Any of those stories.
Yeah, so that does happen. People go through the right steps, and their town says, yeah, okay, we see. Go ahead and put up your tower.
Yeah, maybe right. And there are also towns that just don't want to do it. They you say to them, here's what the law says. They say, that's Washington.
All right. So when I was looking at the pictures of Gary's tower, at the installation, and looking especially at as he was putting in the base, how important is it to get your engineering right?
Well, you need the engineering right at any height, even if it was below the 35 feet allowed by the maximum height of the village. The fight is never on the question of the engineering. There's basically no way I can ever win a case for the radio ham who says, I want to build an antenna system that's not in conformance with the building code.
Can't building codes be obscure and be used to let a village or a town or a city do what they want just because the code itself is so hard to nail down that they can always pick out a loophole in it to deny something?
In extremis, that's why God invented professional engineers.
Okay.
He will stamp things for you.
Okay,
and they will require you to do it the right way.
So you'll probably need a professional engineer to at least help you make sure you go in the right direction, if not build things for you.
I would say that's only necessary if you're in a sticky situation. And this tends to occur where the neighbors are going to hold everyone's feet to the fire. It tends to occur in small lot situations. Let me put it a different way. If you are on 50 acres deep in the woods, you're not going to get into a fight. It's less likely you're going to get into a fight over whether your tower was constructed in accordance with the building code.
Yeah.
I recommend that you build in accordance with the building code in all circumstances, but it's less likely you're going to get into a fight.
I guess what I'm showing here is my ignorance. Never having built a tower, I've helped a couple of hams put up towers. And I believe they did all their own engineering. And whether they did a really good job of it or not, I couldn't tell you. They didn't fall over after being up 10 years. So I guess maybe they did okay. But I don't think
That doesn't mean it was built correctly because... Frankly, most of the towers sold in the United States are built way over the standard safety margins. In steel construction, speaking generally, you have a safety factor of 1.1 or 1.2. Most ham radio designs, as they appear in the catalogs, are... at safety margins of 2-1 and 3-1, just grossly over designed because the manufacturers are always afraid that the radio ham will underbuild. So that it stayed up doesn't necessarily mean it was built in accordance with specs. However, I have to tell you that if you did put up an antenna system and the story goes like this, and it stayed up last winter, it wasn't big enough and it wasn't tall enough.
We've all heard that. How many times have your antennas fallen down?
I've never lost an antenna. I have Rhone 55, 100 feet of Rhone 55 in my backyard. And, you know, I am Caesar's wife. I build correctly.
So, meanwhile, back to Gary and his tower. So the engineering was right. He was building a good substantial tower. Did that come up? Does it come up in do they try to challenge on that?
It hasn't really been an issue in Gary's case, but I've had challenges on these grounds before, and for that reason, I always recommend to my clients that they simply build in accordance with the manufacturer's directions. And I have professional engineers who I work with all the time in various jurisdictions around the United States.
All right. So Gary also mentioned in, I'm not sure where, I think it might have been emailed to me, about that tower that you saw in the background, the power line tower, a couple hundred foot power line tower, and it's about a quarter mile from his house. Is that just a red herring?
Absolutely. There's often a claim by neighbors that this newly constructed amateur radio antenna system, when it goes up, will ruin the neighborhood, cause land prices to sink. And the usual response by the radio ham is to say, yeah, but there's already something nearby, and that didn't cause prices to sink. This entire discussion is irrelevant to the question of reasonable accommodation as required by federal and state law.
And that's the bottom line. That's what we're looking at. Are we meeting that one thing? Is the court always going to ignore the extraneous arguments, or can you run into a judge who just doesn't understand what the law really is? There are such judges, I believe.
There have been examples of cases that have come out badly, and I would have to say that largely, in my opinion, the reason those cases have come out badly had to do with inadequate engineering, inadequate lawyering, and the client ran out of money to appeal it to the next level so that all of the right lawyering and all of the right engineering could be done.
Okay, so a little bit of review. You think you want to put up a tower. First, you got to understand what your local ordinance is. And see what it tells you need to do. Sometimes it can be kind of hard to find or to figure out, or at least to understand.
It's never hard to find. Most communities have it online these days. I haven't actually ordered a printed copy of a zoning ordinance in over 15 years. They've always been online. Then the question is, how do you read it? And the briefest of outlines is, if it has an index, look for the word height, look for the words amateur, look for the word antenna, and go through the definitions section for telecommunications and things like that. See if there's a separate section dealing with cellular telephone. And you've got to read it, and you've got to read it word by word. You can't believe the number of people who think they know what the ordinance says, but they just haven't read it closely. And if they actually sat down and read it, they would know what it says.
Including the city council. Not just the hams, but the lawmakers themselves.
Absolutely.
Haven't been there. In a municipality that has not been through a somewhere between a discussion and a fight with a ham, their ordinance could very well be like the one in Ohio, in Swanton, and be wrong as interpreted by reasonable accommodation. My guess is most of them out there are wrong.
You'd probably be right. In Massachusetts, there are 362 cities and towns, and I'm going to take a wild guess that on the face of them, probably only a quarter of the cities and towns have ordinances that actually meet the requirements of federal law. Because the PRB1 became law in 1985, and a lot of folks just haven't gotten around to it. I guess there hasn't been enough passage of time yet, 85, 95, 05, that's 20, 15, So that's 29 years, is it, since we had PRB1, but they just haven't gotten around to making their laws conform with federal requirements.
Well, how would they know what that PRB1 and the statute that's behind it, how would they know that, that all that exists? A zoning commission that doesn't have a ham on it, or a village board or a town council or whoever's doing the planning for the city, if they're not familiar with ham radio, they're not likely to have encountered this at all, ever.
Most cities and towns belong to the equivalent of what you find in Ohio, which is the Ohio Municipal League. Sometimes it's called the Municipal League of Cities. Sometimes it's the League of Cities. But in any event, in Ohio, it's the Ohio Municipal League. And normally, when a new statute is passed by the legislature, the Municipal League will notify every city and town that's a member of the new ordinance, of the new requirements. And some of them do something about it, and some of them don't.
So that would have happened back in 1985. Or in Ohio's case, the Ohio version of PRB1 actually got enacted in the middle of Gary's tower case.
That's correct, but it wouldn't have changed the outcome because the federal law would say would require the same outcome. But this is where we should give full credit to Nick Pittner, K8NAP, a lawyer in Ohio who served as the Ohio legislative liaison and really pushed, in addition to having some help from the rest of the ARRL structure, to get a new law passed in Ohio.
Yeah, those have been piling up state by state.
I think we're at 29 states now.
Yeah, North Carolina, where I live, passed theirs a few years ago. And
in North Carolina, I was involved in a case in the Charlotte area, Mecklenburg County, where basically the county knows, because I've spent hours on the phone with the director of planning, that they have a problem with an ordinance that doesn't meet the requirements of federal law, and yet they still haven't drafted a revision to meet the requirements of federal law.
And it's tickling my memory. I don't remember any of the details, but I believe there was a ham who challenged it and has lost so far down there.
Well, I happen to represent him as well. That would have been K3 X-Ray Charlie, and that case came to a – he was challenged. The county didn't like what he had done in the way of putting up an antenna. Their ordinance was illegal, and our lawyering on his behalf brought the enforcement action to a standstill, so he wasn't going to go to jail. And Ryan Cairns has now gone off to get an MBA. He sold the house. And so that case has come to a standstill. It would be wrong to say that he lost.
Okay. So the case is the case over with? Since he's
he
not
he sold the house, the tower is down, and he's no longer living there.
If another ham ran into the same situation in that county, would what he has done and what you have done with him be re-energized, or would it be starting over?
Yes. Well, this time around, the parties, the city people, would know what the law requires of them. Whether they would act in accordance with what the law requires them is an open question. They certainly didn't last time around.
How proactive should hams be in ahead of situations like this? First of all, perhaps reviewing their town ordinances to see what they say, to see where they might not meet reasonable accommodation, and then going to their city council, village boards, planning commission, whatever, and trying to get things fixed before someone wants to put up a tower or becomes a challenge. Do you have a recommendation on what ham should be doing there?
Yes. First of all, there's only one organization in the United States that is being proactive, and I told you about the example of K8NAP working really hard to create an Ohio statute, and that is the American Radio Relay League. The ARRL, the National Organization for Amateur Radio, is proactive through its legislative liaisons and section managers in trying to get state laws. As I said, I think we're up to 29 states now. That's very helpful. Second, it's impossible for any organization to go through the ordinance, the zoning ordinances of every city and town in the United States. There are just too many of them. So it's up to the individual radio ham who's living in a particular jurisdiction to take a look at the law that governs him or her. And it might be necessary to be a volunteer on the planning board and suggest a rewrite, or at least meet with the planning board and suggest a rewrite that conforms with the requirements of state and federal law.
Yeah. So it sounds like you're saying, yeah, absolutely, go be proactive, start tomorrow, and find out what's going on in your town. And I imagine a radio club is a good entity to go through rather than just being an individual.
It's individuals who actually do the work, but when the time comes for a public hearing, it's a tremendous advantage to have a huge number of people show up as long as they're not wearing hard hats with antennas coming out of the top.
Torn T-shirts and logos that say hams do it with more frequency. That's always my favorite.
My phrase that I like to suggest to people is that it's a very good idea to have a lot of people show up, but it's not a good idea to bring a riot to a hearing.
Yeah. Don't expect to say anything. Just be there. I guess you need to make it relatively clear that you're there in support of something.
Yes, and individual municipalities have very different ways of doing that. You can sign up sometimes and say what side of the issue you were going to speak on. Many public hearings have a limit of 1, 2, or 3 minutes for people to speak. And after the fourth or fifth person gets up and says the same thing, I'm a radio ham, I'm here in favor of this change in the ordinance, you normally, the chairman of the Board of Appeals or Board of the Planning Board, whoever's handling this matter of the redraft, will say, so I'm getting the sense there are a lot of people here tonight who favor this change. Would you raise your hands? And then we don't have to hear 3 minutes from each of the 27 of you. And it's the polite thing to do. It's just nod, raise your hand, and they get the sense that this is a popular issue. Public officials tend to be sensitive to public opinion.
So in your book, and probably someplace from the league, there is probably draft language to plug in the blanks and present as the model statute that your city could follow.
There's a considerable discussion of model ordinances and model statutes. And the beauty of the United States is that we have a lot of different kinds of regulations. So there's a discussion of what to do in various situations.
No, so it won't be a one-size-fits-all, but a place to start.
Yeah.
All right. There is a mandatory area of discussion that we have to cover here because it is so confused in the minds of so many hams. We have been talking about ordinances, about federal law and state law that affects municipalities, counties, cities, villages, townships, whatever. Nothing to do with the dotted line you signed on when you bought your house in a neighborhood that has a neighborhood homeowners association with codes, covenants, and restrictions does not apply.
The FCC was very specific in creating PRB1 that it does not apply to CC&Rs, common covenants, and restraints of record. These are the things you agreed to as a matter of private contract. The real problem is that there are now many places in the United States where it is next to impossible to buy a home without CC&Rs, the classic example being Foster City, California, where the entire city has a set of CC&Rs that are separate and apart from the zoning ordinance. You cannot buy a single home in Foster City, California that's not controlled by a homeowners association. But I can tell you that older homes, single-family homes, always, in general, there's always a place you can find a single-family home without such things. Now, PRB1 is not necessarily going to help you. Also, if you're a renter, your landlord can control things.
Hadn't even thought of that. A renter is probably not real likely to be able to put up a tower in just about any case.
I've seen plenty of examples where they do. I would tell you that you should be aware of a couple of strategies. I have a bunch of strategies. There's a whole chapter devoted to homeowner associations and strategies involved with what you do before you buy, what to do after you've bought, because there are going to be people who get their licenses long after they've moved into a home controlled by a homeowner association. And the strategies you need to know about involve TV antennas under the so-called OTARD rule, the over-the-air reception devices rule, which is 47 CFR 1.4000, and the Right to Display the American Flag Act. So you may still be able to do something, but if you have a choice, don't buy in a homeowner association controlled situation.
Yeah, some of the comments in that story I referred to from QRZ.com at the beginning of this program said things like, well, you're stupid if you bought a house where your antenna was restricted, your rights to an antenna was restricted by the homeowners association. But what you just said, a lot of people are in the house, then they become a ham. Or there's the spousal factor. And I'll make that genderless. There are lots of reasons why a ham may end up in a house that is restricted.
Actually, I just went through such a thing within the last 3 months with N3JT, who bought a single-family home in a homeowner association-controlled property in Florida, and he was able to get the rules changed to accommodate what he wanted to do, taking a very reasonable approach the whole way along and showing them that it really wouldn't have an impact on the life of the other owners in the association.
So people can be reasonable. You don't want to walk in with the assumption that you're not going to be reasonable, but you don't know what you're going to end up with on the other side.
Every now and then you trip across good people.
Yeah, and more flies with honey.
You bet.
So one last quick thing. In terms of the preemption of homeowners associations, the ARRL has been attempting to get this through for a long time. The FCC has basically said, we're not going to do it, but go to Congress. The ARRL went to Congress. Congress went to the FCC and said, what about this? And the FCC asked for comments. ARRL asked for comments. Not that many overwhelming comments were filed.
No. There were lots of comments.
There were hundreds, but there should have been tens of thousands. I don't think we're ever going to see
both
that.
Both are true.
But the FCC, analysis was, you don't have a problem. That's what they reported back to Congress.
The question that was put to the FCC was, is this necessary for defense purposes?
Well, you're the lawyer. I'm the media. I boil it down to you don't have a problem. But basically it was said,
let's put it this way, the FCC was not helpful.
Yeah. They did not go back to Congress and say a legislation would be a good thing. They said, yeah. So
they did not do that.
When I talked to ARRL officials, they say we're disappointed. I kind of would have liked to have seen them raise a little bit of hell, and they never did that. But they say they're going to, well, and they say we don't want to make anybody mad. Well, people in politics make people mad all the time. But what does it take to make somebody mad and get away with it? I don't need a legal definition.
Hard question to answer.
Okay. Would you agree that we're probably better off not making anybody mad about this and still being the good guys and saying, let's try again?
It's going to take a long-term, concerted lobbying effort.
And that equates to the ARRL just because, I mean, we don't have a huge lobby, and we don't have a lot of money for a lobby. We have the league and a couple of guys in D.C.
Correct.
and they do what they can.
Exactly.
And one congressman with a ham license. And he was the one who got this pushed through, I believe.
Yes. So. From Oregon or Washington.
Yeah. All right. So that's the book, Antenna Zoning for the Radio Amateur. If you think you want to put up a tower, or even in some cases, I guess, just a dipole might need some help from this. I mean, you know, sometimes it gets that tough. Start there and make sure you've got everything lined up correctly. And then if you run into trouble, a local attorney and that local attorney, you probably never want just you, or do you? Could it be just you, or do you always need somebody local? You've got to be licensed in the state you're going to practice. You didn't. Did you go to the trial in Ohio, or did you attend?
You've misstated the law.
Okay. Of course. I'm the media.
We have more and more today of what is called multi-jurisdictional practice. I'm a living, breathing example of American Bar Association Model Rule 5.5C2, which means that if I reasonably expect to be admitted subsequently to appear for one time only in a particular matter, I can appear at the first level where there's no judge to grant me permission to appear. In some states, they don't have the ABA model rule. Ohio is one of them. And in the Ohio case, and I've done it in New Jersey and in a bunch of other jurisdictions, I file to be admitted pro hac vice for one time only to appear on behalf of Radio Ham. It's often useful to have a local attorney in the jurisdiction to coordinate with, but I've also handled a lot of cases without ever having a local attorney. Both systems work. I guess there's always a small advantage, at least a small advantage, to having a local attorney work with me.
Okay. But a ham, is their first step is to learn what they need to do and file the right papers and documents for variances or permissions or whatever they've got to do. Should they go through a lawyer first before they do any of that, just to look it all over?
Well, first of all, the right filing at the initial stage saves a lot of grief, because then you have something that's defensible from day one. I'll tell you, the two cases I personally consider disasters. One was a California case where the ham never specified the antenna. He just talked about his tower, and that was a disaster. Because we didn't have the documentation from day one. And the South Carolina case, the other big disaster in my mind, had no needs analysis submitted, and the ham pretty much lost because of that.
Okay,
starting the right way is the right thing to do, but you would expect me to say that, you know.
Yeah, but most of us are not qualified to know what the right way is, so you probably need that local lawyer and someone who can understand the law, or is it something someone should? Is it possible to run something by you or another antenna law expert quickly to say, here's my initial stuff, do you see any red flags?
It's possible to run something by me or anybody else who's well-equipped. But remember, lawyers have only one thing to sell. A stock and trade for an attorney is time.
Yeah.
So even if you're just looking for, yes, is this a good idea kind of thing, you're going to wind up paying for it.
Yeah, you get a bill for the hour or two that took to do the research and figure out the right answer.
Sometimes an hour or two is not all it takes. I can tell you that
you can tell where I'm hoping.
Past several years, that initial phone call, just to give you a real life example, that initial phone call with me is going to cost you $1,500.
Okay,
that's my.
I was going to ask if you would state a ballpark figure to get started.
The retainer to get the case going is going to be $1,500. That is for the initial consultation and research. You're never going to see that money again. I burn it off as we go along, but I really don't work in... it's way too dangerous to have a ham call me up and say, here's what the law says, here's what I want to do, what's going to happen? If I answer that question, big trouble is going to erupt, because I got to tell you, it's really a terrible idea to accept what the person at the counter at town hall tells you is the law as a true statement of the law. And it's a terrible idea for me to accept what the radio ham thinks the person at the counter said is the law as the law.
Yeah.
I have to do that research myself. I won't trust your word for it. Sorry about that, Gary.
I'm guessing that if I were to ask you for a range of costs from high to low, it not only would you be reluctant to want to make one, but it would be irrelevant. So useless to attempt to apply to anyone in individual case to begin with, that why bother?
That's true. I have seen expensive cases on big pieces of rural land and cheap cases on small lots in cities. They vary widely, but this I will say. Speaking generally, it's hard to find a situation where the lawyering will be less than the cost of the tower and antenna system.
That is sobering for anyone who doesn't have serious money to commit to. In other words, if you have bought a tower at a flea market for 10 bucks a section, it's a little bit rusty somewhere, and you're thinking you can put up 100 feet of Rhone 25 for $125, probably misleading yourself, heading for trouble. I mean, you might be able to do it, but I'm kind of worried about that.
Well, let me give you a real life quick answer. In my career, I have run into exactly one municipality where no building permit was required. So a building permit, whether it's a special permit or variance, but a building permit is always going to be required, speaking generally. And for that building permit, you are essentially putting yourself at the mercy of the building inspector, and he can require documentation that satisfies him. And that's really subjective. So as long as he's being reasonable, you have to be able to provide what he's asking you for. You'll need to meet the building code. And besides, it's a good idea to meet the building code. You know, especially if you're going to climb it.
So Gary Wadtke is going to have another hearing. Is there going to be a hearing for the appeal? Or is that more administrative, looks at the facts and figures out whether the decision was correct in the first place or not?
We don't yet know whether the court is going to want oral argument. I've had cases before that went off without any appearance by the attorney in court. We just filed all the papers and the judges made the decisions.
So we'll wish him good luck. And
we certainly do. He's a nice guy. His construction is immaculate and the law's on his side.
Yeah. And you are, in the course of this conversation, you have sounded very bullish on positive prospects for hams getting their antennas up. Maybe not the 250-foot tower they would like, but something reasonable, something really reasonable for the situation that they're in. You think?
No, I want to emphasize that's not the law.
I screwed it up.
The ham doesn't, in the sense that you mean it, the ham doesn't have to be reasonable. It's the municipality that has to accommodate the need of the radio ham. Now, it can't be an outlandish need. It can't be an impossible need. It can't be a need which bears no relationship to real life. But if he can document the need, then the municipality has an obligation to accommodate it. Yeah. That's what the law says. The municipality must engage in a reasonable accommodation of the radio amateur's need for effective communications.
All right. And that's what I mean by you're being bullish about it. You think that most of the time that is going to prevail.
That's right. It's the obligation of the town to accommodate the ham, not the obligation of the ham to accommodate the town.
Yep. But it could end up being expensive, and you may have to pay to play.
Sometimes it costs to defend your rights.
Yeah. All right. Fred Hopengarten, K1VR, ham radio attorney. There's your book on the ARRL website.
It's available from HRO, Array Solutions, Ham Radio Bookstore, and the ARRL.
Okay, good deal. Thank you for your time, expertise, and valuable advice. I think
my pleasure. Show up in Dayton, and we'll have a cup of coffee.
We may have saved some folks some heartache, if not some money.
Let me just make sure you understand one thing, though, as we depart.
Sure.
My hobby is ham radio. My hobby is not being the lawyer for radio ham.
That's got to be the case for lawyers in every walk of life. Free advice because you happen to be within a 3-foot radius.
It's the case for every profession. My wife is a physician, and yeah. I got to tell you, she gets questions. And she has something that she can do that I can't do. She says, come on by the office.
So take 2 aspirin and call me in the morning.
Actually, what she says to me is take 2 aspirin and go to bed with your doctor.
Sounds like good advice. Every once in a while, someone asks me, how can I get into the announcing business? And I say, if you find out, let me know. Still trying. Thank you, Fred. Been good talking to you.
It's been a real treat.
And that is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. A reminder, Arvin is still sitting back there. Oh, by the way, this fella here, Chris Meyer, tossed me $20 for doing this show. Perhaps you will do something like that. I will see you next time. Heading down to the Charlotte Ham Fest for the weekend. Over and out.